Some people say that the golden age of serial killers ended with three letters. DNA. A single hair, a drop of blood, a trace of saliva. Suddenly, the monsters of the past could be unmasked. And the would-be serial killers of the future, they had a reason to think twice. But did DNA really shut the door on the golden age of serial killers? Can science really silence that kind of depraved compulsion? Or did the monsters just learn to hide better? The very first time I remember even hearing about DNA, I wasn't thinking about crime scenes or detectives. I was a kid watching Jurassic Park.
A DNA strand like me is a blueprint for building a living thing.
Remember that guy? He explained how scientists cloned dinosaurs using fossilized mosquito blood. Dino DNA. As a kid, that was basically my crash course in genetics. I mean, I didn't totally get it, and to be honest, it's a pretty far-fetched little plot line there, but I walked out of the theater thinking DNA was basically magic. A secret code locked inside every living thing. Then years later, when I started getting a little more into like true crime and stuff like that, I realized that same code that fascinated me as a kid wasn't just science fiction. It was the tool pulling real monsters out of hiding. But that wasn't always the case. Okay, really quick, before I go any further, welcome to Breakfast Cereal. My name's Josh. If you've been following along on this channel at all recently, you know that this is part of a series I've been making asking, where did all the serial killers go? What killed the so-called golden age of serial killers? You know, that strange, terrifying stretch in the 70s and 80s when it felt like Kemper and Bundy and BTK were everywhere all at once. Each episode, I pick apart a different theory that's out there and just ask a lot of questions. And you know what? I love to hear all your theories and comments too, so make sure you get in there down in the comments on this video. And hey, don't forget to subscribe if you like this video. Before the 1980s, catching a serial killer was like trying to solve a puzzle with half the pieces missing. Detectives had fingerprints if the suspect had a record. They had eyewitness testimony, which was often, frankly, pretty unreliable. They had blood typing, which could maybe narrow a suspect pool down to, oh, I don't know, like 40% of the population. If you were unlucky enough to be the victim of a serial killer in those years, chances were good your murder would go unsolved. See, the bad guys knew that if they just kept their mouths shut, cops didn't have much to work with. But then, in 1986, everything changed. England. In a town called Narborough, two young girls were murdered. Police were desperate. So they brought in a geneticist. This guy, Alec Jeffries. Now, Jeffries had recently developed a new technique. DNA fingerprinting. No one had ever used it in a criminal case before. The suspect, Colin Pitchfork, yeah, that's his name. Colin Pitchfork's DNA was tested against the crime scene evidence and it matched. He became the first person in history convicted by DNA. That was the crack in the dam, or I guess we should say the pitchfork in the road. I mean, look at his face. That guy looks fucking blindsided. DNA? The hell is that? Suddenly, the tiniest speck of blood, the faintest touch of saliva, a single hair follicle could become the loudest witness in the courtroom. Every serial killer who had built his career on shadows and silence suddenly had something new to fear. Joseph James D'Angelo. He wore two masks. By day, he's a police officer. By night, he was the original Night Stalker, the man who later became known as the Golden State Killer. In the 70s and 80s, he committed at least 13 murders across California. Then he vanished. Poof. For decades, the case went cold. And then, genealogy. Investigators uploaded old DNA samples from crime scenes into a public database used for family history. It was like 23andMe or Ancestry.com, something like one of those sites. Anyways, it's not important. They were able to basically build a family tree, cousins, siblings, and the branches, they all led back to one man, Joseph D'Angelo. In 2018, police followed him, collected his DNA from a discarded tissue, and the match lit up like a siren. After 40 years of mystery, the Golden State Killer was unmasked. But hold on a sec. While we're talking about D'Angelo, his last murder was in 1986. Then he seemingly just stopped. He wasn't caught until 2018. So why would he stop? 1986. Why does that sound familiar? Right. It's the same year that Jeffrey's DNA fingerprinting was first used to get the conviction. Remember? I mean, we just talked about it a minute ago. That's enough for a lot of people on the internet. Like this here Reddit post, for example, to speculate that the advent of DNA technology was enough to scare D'Angelo into remission, so to speak. So could that theory hold true for other would-be serial killers? How prevalent is it? Well, you ever heard of CODIS? I mean, I hadn't before researching for this video. It stands for the Combined DNA Index System. Basically, the FBI's giant database of genetic fingerprints. Think of it like the ultimate phone book, except instead of names and numbers, it's filled with profiles built from blood, saliva, and hair samples. Now, back in 1990, CODIS only had a few thousand entries. Practically nothing. But then, look at this graph. The line shoots upward through the 90s, past the 2000s, and today it's sitting at over 20 million profiles. That means if you so much as leave behind a single hair or drop of blood, there's a decent chance it's gonna ping against something already in that system. And one more, look at this. This shows cold cases solved in the last 20 years. And DNA is behind nearly half of them. Maybe not every case, but enough that it's become the single biggest driver of breakthroughs. Seems to me like that should be enough to scare anyone with half a brain away from becoming a serial killer this day and age, right? Well, not so fast. I'm not so sure. Because when you look at someone like this guy, Russell Williams, the argument starts to wobble. Williams wasn't a drifter. He wasn't a loner living on the fringes of society. He was one of the most successful men in Canada's military. A decorated colonel. He commanded an Air Force base. He had medals. This was a man who had everything going for him. He was entrusted with the highest of responsibilities. He flew the prime minister. He flew foreign dignitaries. He even piloted a plane carrying the fucking Queen of England. That's how high this guy had risen. You don't get much more successful or more trusted than that. He had a marriage, a beautiful home, the kind of life most people would guard at all costs. If anyone had everything to lose, it was Russell Williams. And he lived in a world saturated with DNA. This was 2010. Every police procedural on television was hammering the point home. You can't get away with anything anymore. Every cigarette butt, every scrap of fabric, every hair follicle could betray you. If anyone should have known better, it was him. And still, he acted. Williams broke into homes to steal women's underwear. He escalated to assaults, then to murder. He took trophies. He documented everything with photos. For all of his knowledge of the modern world, for all his success and power, he couldn't resist his compulsions. That's the part that I can't shake. If DNA really scared away would-be serial killers, how do you explain a man like that? A man at the absolute peak of society who knew exactly how modern investigations worked, and he still risked everything. It really makes me wonder if DNA can really scare off the kind of person driven by this sort of compulsion. Maybe it can shorten their so-called careers. Maybe it can force more caution. But can it erase the urge itself? Psychologists who've studied serial killers usually say no. Compulsion doesn't respond to logic. It doesn't weigh pros and cons like you or I would. Robert Ressler, the FBI profiler who literally coined the term serial killer, often described it like an itch. An uncontrollable drive that builds until it demands release. Psychologists like Stanton Samnow, the author of Inside the Criminal Mind, and a guy who spent decades studying offenders, argue that deterrence isn't really the issue. For people wired this way, it's about a need, a compulsion that overrides fear of punishment. And if that's true, then maybe the golden age of serial killers didn't really end. Because if someone like Russell Williams couldn't stop himself, even with everything to lose, even in a world saturated with DNA, then what does that tell us? Maybe the people who fit that mold today, the scariest, the most disturbed, aren't gone. They're just harder to see, more careful, more deliberate. Because compulsion doesn't bow to science. And that might be the most unsettling thought of all. Not that DNA scared away the monsters, but that it pushed the ones who still exist deeper into the shadows.